driven in aboard the Rolls-Royce 1920 Soul Car. So, ladies and gentlemen, once he halts in front of the vehicles, please give a big round of applause to Mr. David Fletcher, historian, author, and expert in the history of armour. Over to you.
Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I've been sent out to do a tank chat about these First World War tanks. And we've chosen a good year because 2017, 1917, got 100 years exactly apart. And of these three, the only tank which is genuine from that period, from 1917, is the Saint-Chamond, the French tank at the end, sent over by courtesy of the Musée de Blonde in Saumur. Mark IV was made for a movie fairly recently for War Horse, and of course the A7V was constructed for us by Bob Grundy up in Wigan. So they're probably a bit artificial, but for our purposes to discuss what the different tanks are like, they're probably as good as anything you'll see anywhere. Now we'll start with the Saint-Chamond because it is the original tank and well worth looking at. The first thing you'll notice, it's like the A7V in that it runs on the same kind of crawler gear as the original Holt Caterpillar tractors from the United States, which is where both the French and the Germans got their inspiration from. That's why it's so different in outline from the British tank in the middle. It's powered by a 19 horsepower Panhard petrol engine that drives a 52 kilowatt generator, which in turn drives two electric motors. Now those electric motors drive the tracks, and in theory, these electric drives they have now is ideal for tanks because you have no gear changing, no gearbox to worry about at all. You can just go right up to full speed, a good 5 miles an hour if you're lucky. But the trouble with petrol electric is the room it takes up inside the tank and the weight of it. It tends to make the tank heavier than it needs to be. Saint-Chamond got over that quite well compared to some rival designs, which are awful. So it's quite an interesting tank from that. Takes a crew of 9, had 30 millimetres of armour on the front, and about 8 or 9 millimetres usually on the side, although they did up armour some of them later. You can see the driver sits in the depoter at the front on the left, and in front of him on the front plate is the gun, and it's a 75mm weapon. It's in fact the famous Soissons cannon, the French 75mm field gun, arranged to work in a tank and works perfectly. The tank is also equipped with Hotchkiss air-cooled machine guns, with one in the front on the other side of the main gun, one on each side and one at the back. The other interesting thing is that the Saint-Chamond, unlike any other tank I can ever remember, actually has a rear driver. It is possible to drive the tank in reverse from the back to get it out of trouble. And they needed this because one thing you'll notice, and you can see it quite well from this angle, is how much of the tank is overhanging at the front and the back, something you won't find on the British tank. You've got traction, right, and they're quite well clear of the ground, but that overhang tended to dig in. If the tank encountered a trench or a shell hole in the battlefield, it was just as likely to get stuck as anything else. They didn't fall over, thank goodness, like the German ones, but they had a nasty habit of getting stuck. And that's the cause of it, that long overhang at the front and back. The Saint-Chamond, they were built actually as a rival to the French Schneider. Schneider had been produced without going to the usual channels. So Saint-Chamond, which is a firm FAMA, which I won't bother to even try and pronounce, so I won't repeat pig's ear of it, but they were based at Saint-Chamond, which is near Lyon, and they built 400 of these machines. They're all slightly different. These later ones have the angled roof and the did one cupola. The original ones had a flat roof with two cupolas, and they're quite an unusual looking tank in many ways. But they were used by the French army from, I think, their first encounter with Lafayette, which was 5th of May 1917. That was the first time the Saint-Simon was in action. So here we are, 100 years later. It's very, very good to see this tank here today. Now in front of it and facing us is the Mark IV. It's a replica, as I say, it's not the original. So inside it is slightly different. And we're going to look at it as if it were the real thing. Otherwise it would get very boring and I don't know what I'm talking about. Inside it had a Daimler 105 horsepower six-cylinder engine. And I ought to say it straight away that the Daimler engine in this tank is a British Daimler. They were made in Coventry and were no connection with the German company at all, apart from the name itself. It was a totally different company and they produced the engine, which had the Nike sleeve valve system on it, which is quite unusual. It gave rise to what was known as the Silent Night type of engine. And that's located in the centre of the tank, with the crew working round it. Now, back from the engine, you've got a two-speed gearbox, two-speed in reverse anyway, which is the same as you get in a Daimler vehicle, and then a differential, the same as the back axle of the car, only about 4 times as big, and then the half shafts going out to each side. And those half shafts actually end in secondary gearboxes. So you actually need two other men stationed in the back of the tank to change the secondary gears if you need them. It's to give them a higher range of gears, give you 4 speeds instead of 2. But they use these gears for steering, by knocking one set of gears into neutral, having the other in drive, and then applying a brake to the other track. You could spin the track tank round more or less where it stood. That was the idea behind it. It meant that four men out of the 8 men in the tank crew were all engaged in driving the tank, which is not really very convenient. And bearing in mind that inside it's very hot, very, very noisy with that engine going and fumes floating about everywhere, they can't really think or see what one another are doing. They can't hear one another speak at all. So you find that unless you had good teamwork, unless you had people who really knew their stuff, who could change gear quickly, because every time this tank changes gear, it has to stop. And that's a great advantage of the petrol electric system in the French tank, that it will accelerate through what would be the gears, from naught to whatever speed you like, and all do it without stopping. With the Mark IV, you had to stop to change gear every single time. So even when it turned, you had to stop, alter the gears, turn, alter the gears again, and then go straight ahead. So you had to do 3 stops with every single turn. They were slow, very laborious things to see going. But quite an interesting vehicle to say. The Mark IV has 12 millimeters of armor on the front of the cab, and about 8 millimeters on the sides. It was really designed only to keep out small arms fire and shells and fragments. It wasn't really any good at resisting the fire of a real shell. If it hit it, it blew it apart. But that was a risk they had to take. Quite interesting is that they built 1,200 of these Mark IVs. They built 400 of the Saint-Simon. So they built quite a lot of both. Considering the tank was a complete novelty, no one had ever tried anything like it before, and that really helped to establish the tank in the first place. Bearing in mind that in 1917, the tank was less than a year old anyway, so it's quite amazing that they got as far as they did. You'll notice also with the British tank that the guns, which are 57mm, 6 pounder guns, are carried in sponsons at the side. They've got about a 90 degree arc of fire, so they'll fire more or less straight ahead, but normally you're firing out on the flank where you get a better effect, and you've got a gun on each side to do it. They're also equipped with Lewis guns as their machine gun, and the Lewis gun was introduced in 1917 in 1916 and in 1918 afterwards, we used the air called Hotchkiss, like the French tank. It was actually a French machine gun altered to take the British caliber rounds. And someone came along who was said to be an expert at the time and said, oh, I recommend the Loose, which was an idea, it was a perfect good weapon, except that in a tank, it's air cooled and the airflow is drawn into the gunner's face by the fumes from inside the air moving about inside the tank. And it made them very difficult to operate from that point of view. But you do find this a characteristic of these 1917 tanks. And they did pretty well, all things considered. The tanks got a fairly slow top speed, about 3 to 4 miles an hour. It's about walking pace, really. The idea was that it would keep pace with the infantry who were advancing with the tank into action, and they wouldn't lose it. They could stay with it the whole time. And that's really what lies behind the British design. But by putting the tracks all the way around, they came up with a tank which could cope with trenches, shell holes and that sort of thing, normally without coming to any serious risk. And if they did get a problem, you've got a thing on there called the unditching beam, which is near the back of the tank and it's carried on rails. And with the unditching beam, you carry that on the back, and when you get stuck, you find a couple of idiots in the tank who like being shot at, and you send them outside. They chain the beams to the tracks, and then the tracks drag, which are slipping, of course, they're not going anywhere, drag the beam around so it's underneath the tank, and the tank climbs out over it. It's really quite impressive to see it going. It doesn't do the thing a lot of good, so we won't demonstrate it. The other tank is the German A7B. Now the Germans, contrastingly with their behaviour in the Second World War, were very, very reticent about tanks in the First World War. They only built 20 of those. They started work on them in 1917. They saw a bit of action in 1918, but really 20 isn't many. They used more British tanks that they captured than they did of their own construction. Now the A7B uses the Holt suspension, exactly the same as the Saint-Germain, except that it's more overhung by the hull and much lower down. You'll see with the Saint-Germain, very, very interesting vehicles, but not up to the standard of the British tank as a cross-country vehicle or anything else. And that really is the collection. We brought out for the three tanks, one French, one British, one German, all within 100 years of their first invention. And that really is quite something. Thanks very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for that round of applause for David Fletcher. David, thank you. A tour de force, a man with the most knowledge about AFVs, their history, and everything else. David, thank you very much indeed. So, ladies and gentlemen, the time is now shortly before 12:30. You now have about an hour and 20 minutes before we get into the afternoon programme.